Great. Okay. Good morning. Hello, everyone. I'm going to be talking to you in a few minutes about ES6. I think I can actually see everyone. There are lots of spaces up here in case you want to move a little further up to be able to ask me questions more effectively, because I am going to be asking you to do that many times during this talk. I just tweeted my slides, and they are interactive. So if you have computers, as many of you do in front of you, you can open them up, type into them, click the fancy run button, and play along with me as I go through many different pieces of ES6. So ECMAScript 6 or ECMAScript 2015. So how many of you have heard of this, the new version of JavaScript? Okay, and how many of you have actually used it? Okay, great. So at least in the last talk, you heard and saw a lot of ES6 up here. So I'm going to be explaining some of those features as we go through. ECMAScript 6, or ECMAScript 2015, as the new name is the next version of JavaScript that's currently being implemented in most browsers. It has been a very long time coming. The last version of JavaScript that was ratified was 2009. And it didn't even have that many really cool things in it. And I'll get into that in a little bit. But we've all been very, very patient to have waited this long for all of these pieces. So my name is John Paul. I love JavaScript. I have dalliances and indiscretions with other programming languages every once in a while. But I always come back from the Scalas and Javas of the world to JavaScript. If you want to take a look at the slides, just go to my Twitter handle or the jQuery.conf hashtag, and you will see it. So first, I'd want to talk to you about what ECMAScript is. So ECMA is an international standards body. It is like IETF or IEEE. They have standardized a few things, most notably the amazing thing that we used to call the cloud, the floppy disk. They also standardize Dart. They standardize C#. They standardize a few different pieces of the internet world that we don't typically think about. Their official standard body adopted scripting language is ECMAScript, which is what we lovingly call JavaScript. So ECMA International is the standards body that puts together the specification every however many years. The particular group within the ECMA standards body is called TC39. There's a lot of jargon and lingo here that you don't necessarily need to know. But ECMAScript has had a few major revisions. ECMAScript version 3 was put together in 1999, most notably added regular expressions. Can you imagine life without regular expressions? It also added try and catch, some pretty staple ideas in programming languages we gratefully got in JavaScript in 1999. And then there was a 10-year-long gap. So despite how impatient we might have been, we've been pretty used to it as JavaScript developers because it's already taken a very long time for us to get new pieces of the language. In ECMAScript 5, we got things like array.map. A lot of extensions that prototype.js added were actually integrated into the language. And now in 2015, we have ECMAScript 6. So I'm going to start going through some features of ECMAScript 6. It has been a long time coming. The language version numbers have now changed from integers from starting from something low, like 3, 4, 5, 6, and have moved to the years in which they will be released. So the next version is not ECMAScript 7 anymore. It is ECMAScript 2016, 2017, 2018. The reasoning behind this is that when a year is actually attached to a document, it is forced to go out in that year, and we no longer have to wait for some arbitrary number of years in the future. This is a good idea for your own projects. Name everything by the year, and you'll have to get something out by December. So 2015, this is the new name for ECMAScript 6. You'll still see lots of blog posts about with both different names, but they mean the same thing, ECMAScript 6 and ECMAScript 2015. So I want to talk to you a little bit about why I am such a huge fan of the software industry. So one thing that I really love about being in software and being in programming languages in general is that there's basically zero cost for plagiarism. We can steal the best ideas in other programming languages. We can steal the best abstractions, the best patterns from other technologies, integrate them into our own workflow, into our own programming languages, at basically zero cost, and no one's really going to complain to us. If anything, people are going to be happy, because then they can come to this language more easily. They can mentally map between, oh, that thing, I know that from Python. I know that from Java. I know that from C#, and they can more easily integrate into the language of the web, JavaScript. So what we have been doing in ECMAScript as the years have gone on has been taking features that have been popularized in other programming languages and incorporating them into the JavaScript standard. There are a few here. There are many more than just this. But we've been taking blatantly from other programming languages. CoffeeScript gave us arrow functions. Python has generators, and we have very, very similar semantics around ours. Destructuring, that I'll show you a little bit later, came directly from Lisp. C has const and block scope and lots of other things that ECMAScript 2015 has. And then actually, there is a language called E, which I did not know about until researching this, that actually was a direct copy for where we took template strings for ECMAScript 2015 from. It is not what Ruby has or what other programming languages have, but it is directly from a language called E. Has anyone ever heard of E before? I have no idea what it does except for having template strings. But I'd be excited if someone here was like, yes, I know E. I wrote E way back when. Great. So the plan for what I'm going to talk about is I've broken up my talk into a few different workshop components that will hopefully help you very easily and very quickly be able to go back to your day jobs and integrate these pieces into your systems without having to wait weeks or months or for standards bodies to do what they need to do or anything like that. So the first group that I'm going to talk about are the pieces of ECMAScript 2015 that are able to be shimmed into your current projects as easy as dropping in a script tag. The second group are the transpilables. So how many of you use CoffeeScript? TypeScript? Okay. So there is a whole subset of ECMAScript 2015 that can be transpiled into ES5. Similarly to how CoffeeScript and TypeScript work, you can take one piece of source code, convert it into JavaScript, and we can get a whole bunch of new features like that. And then there are features that are very difficult to actually use that I'll cover for a little bit until the actual implementations themselves build into the implementation the language feature. I'll talk a little bit about that. So as I go through this, again, if you have laptops, you can definitely follow along and play with me. I would love to encourage all of you here. So how many of you went to Darcy's talk yesterday? Okay, so he's talking again later today, but he has this idea of interaction that is giving away stickers. And I'm going to do something similar, except I'm going to bribe you all for questions, because one, you are all on the hook for making sure that I speak on time and that I leave here on time, and also that I actually take that whole time. So I would love for all of you to ask me questions. Feel free to interrupt me. This is much more of an interactive workshop than it is anything else. I have an entire bag of stickers here. For everyone who is willing to ask me a question, they can come up and get random stickers from JavaScript to grunt to gulp to also whatever else happens to be in this bag. So, as you are at jQueryConf, I know there is at least one thing you know how to do, which is add the jQuery script tag to your pages. That is, there's at least that minimum. You might not know JavaScript, you might not know anything about what, you know, a jQuery element is doing, but you know how to add a script tag. And as script tags, as I said earlier, JavaScript is my favorite language, script tags are my favorite HTML tag, I know that there's this one thing that you can do, regardless of what platform you happen to be using. You can be in Joomla world, Drupal world, fancy new C# applications, or whatever. You can always add a single script tag. So I'm gonna talk to you about some great new features we're able to use by just adding a script tag. All we have to do is add a script tag to this ES6 shim by Paul Miller, and we get many of these features that I'll go through, and some, and many, many more. I have only put on here, I don't know, about 10 of them. They're on the order of 25 or 30 different shimmable features of ECMAScript 6. So this is a pattern that I am sure all of us here have written 1,000 times. We have a string. We want to check if a certain character or string of characters is in that string. And how do we do that? We use this fancy magical incantation, which is dot index of being greater than -1. And if we run this, you see it does say true. Can you see that? Yes. And this does work. This is one of those things that especially people coming to JavaScript from other programming languages, bang their head against the wall for a while to understand why we have to memorize this thing. Gratefully, in ECMAScript 6, ECMAScript 2015, we just have this, which gives you the same thing with the beautiful new fluent syntax that actually makes sense when you read it out loud. All you need is a script tag. Isn't it wonderful? So then, additional, so in ECMAScript 2015, we've actually standardized the promises A plus implementation and built that into the language itself. We don't have to rely on libraries, although if you do have jQuery and jQuery 3.0, you will have a very similar thing given to you by a library. The language itself actually supports it now. And this will work. So how many of you use promises? Okay, so the idea here is, using promises, we have an abstraction around asynchronous events that is a little bit more useful and usable than a callback. So in this case, I am creating a promise. For that promise, I am resolving it after 1,000 milliseconds. And after that promise is resolved, I will alert something. And here we'll find that 1 second is much longer than any of us ever think. There it is. It took a little bit. But so this is another feature of the language that's actually built in. We don't have to rely on libraries like Bluebird or Q or jQuery. The language itself has promises now built in. What questions do you have? Yes. Yes, it is. So I think it is actually just promise.all. But it's something I will look. So the question was, promise libraries typically have a way to aggregate multiple promises and give you a single fulfillment handler to say, when all of these different things are done, then execute what I need to execute in terms of a callback. That is also included. Almost everything that libraries currently provide is either included or can be extended to. Yes? I do not believe so, but I have to look that up. I don't know if promises are, I don't think that promises are cancelable, but I don't know. I don't think so. Yes? Sure, so the question was, well, I think it was the question. The question was a statement that Q and other promise libraries have memory leaks in them, does this. So one of the difficulties that Q would have in implementing something like this is that as a user land library, it cannot guarantee as much as an implementation in the language can guarantee. So there are optimizations that the language could actually make that Q cannot make. I don't know as to specific benchmarks around the language implementations of this. But I'll tell you that for the shim that I've been talking about that you can just add with a single script tag, whatever limitations would be there for ECMAScript 5 would be there anyway, because all this is doing is shimming the same thing. So over the course of time, as this is built into browsers and built into JavaScript engines, most of those will go away. What other questions do you have? Okay, so again, promises been added into the standard library. For many years, so the JavaScript standard library in general has been tiny compared to the world of Java, C#, Python, Ruby, all of those things. We have been growing that very significantly with the advent of ECMAScript 2015. How am I doing? Are you all keeping track of my time, right? You all promised. At least half of you raised your hand. I know it. So, next, we have been given a piece of functionality called object.assign. Object.assign is a very similar functionality to jQuery.extend, _.extend. It merges multiple JavaScript objects into one. This is something that many libraries provided. JavaScript has paved the cow paths, which is a term that is used a lot for JavaScript language extension. That means that the JavaScript standard body decided to adopt what everyone was doing anyway and build that into the language so we do not have to continue to reinvent that wheel. Here you will see that object.assign, it is a function that can take multiple objects, it merges them together and puts all of the keys together. This is fairly straightforward, and again, something that we do not anymore need libraries for. I think we saw an example of this in Bodil's talk earlier with Asosh. So I'm pretty sure, yeah. Again, the JavaScript language gives you that now. Additionally, again, for very familiar purposes for the Java C Sharp world, we have, yes, please. It overrides from the right will override, I believe. The furthest parameter over will overwrite. So it does copy, but if there are multiple keys with the same value, actually, I'll try that. Give me one second. Yes. So if you have two of the same key in multiple objects, the second one overrides. Gratefully, with slides like this, you can just try it all. So what are the questions that you have? No, so sorry, I understand the question. So it assigns all of the properties. The typical pattern to do what you're describing is this. So it assigns everything in the subsequent parameters to the first one. That is the official semantics. I guess that is the same as jQuery.extended _.extended, right? Great. So for sets. So is everyone here a JavaScript daily developer, or do they use other languages? Other languages. Okay. So for the Java-minded, so I was a Java developer for a while. That's why I use this as analogies more often than not. I was a Java developer and then a JavaScript developer and found that, I can build user interfaces where my parents can actually see what I'm doing. That's great. And then I continued with that, and it was great. So the JavaScript standard library in ECMAScript 2015 additionally adds sets. So here an example that is very straightforward in the Javas and C Sharps of the world. We tried to add multiple Bs in this example, but actually when you run it, there are only three items inside when you call set.size. And there is only A, B, and C because sets automatically unique in dedupe, so you cannot add two of the same item to it. If you use objects, it uses triple equals the exact memory location for an object. And again, sets are now completely out of the box for you, instead of having to rely on many good implementations in NPM, but all very distinct implementations in NPM. So now, a little more complicated example. So again, as other programming languages have, we now no longer have to rely on object to be our generic key value pair for anything. We now have maps, and the biggest distinction between maps and objects is that map keys don't have to be strings. Right now, if you try to use an object as a key in another object, it actually calls to string on that object and uses that string, which is sort of convoluted and very confusing if you actually run into a bug that you created because you assumed that you could use an object as a key. Now, maps in ECMAScript 2015 are able to take as a key more than just a string. Here in this example, we create a map, we set key as value, we check. Here's an example of an object that has a key named key and a val assigned to it, and a map that looks very similar that has a key and a val. The two different ways to look up into that is, for an object, you use the key in syntax. For a map, we use the has syntax. So here, these are roughly the same. And for a string, they're almost exactly equivalent. But for a map, we can also put in as a key an object. And we can specify. Oops. Now, it actually has that object, but if I create a second one, now, even though these two things are exactly the same in terms of their values, when I try to see if the map has it, it says false, because these two objects are actually different objects in memory. When I try to get that, it gives me nothing, because it's not there. Whereas here, I am able to look that up. So in ECMAScript 2015, using maps, we are able to use objects as keys. You can use DOM nodes. You can use pretty much anything as a distinct key, rather than having to rely on two string and needing to make sure that every object has different values inside of it to make a difference. Yes? So maps also have the iterable interface. So map, I think I understand your question. Let me see if I can. So do you have to use new? Is that the question? Ah, I see. I do not believe so. Map is not a function. So no, you cannot. Yes. I do not believe so either. You cannot do that, but let's see if this works. No. But you can use, so maps are also iterable, which I'll talk a little bit later. So ECMAScript 2015, again, I don't know if I go through this significantly, has added a new feature where you can make your own objects iterable. This is another thing that other languages have. Iterables have a .next, similar kind of thing, where you can create objects that are able to be used in the language with the for of syntax. So for of is a new, similar to for in. I'll show you that example here. For. I believe that should work. All right. So using this new syntax, I'm conflating multiple things here, but you've seen at least one example of this before. This is using the syntax something of map. The of is the key piece here. For of is a new looping mechanism in JavaScript, in ECMAScript 2015. The for of loop can be used with your own objects as long as they implement the iterable interface. Maps implement the iterable interface. So you can pluck out of a map a key and a value that, in this case, let me separate this easily. And here you see key and val, because maps are iterable. You can't look up by square bracket, but you can iterate through all of them. They are unordered, but they will work. What other questions do you have? Okay. Yes, actually. So I don't remember the syntax for that. Okay, the question was, can you create a map from an array? You can definitely create an array from a map as well. Arrays have array.from. So you can go that way. Array.from was something that will convert almost any iterable into an array of keys and values, keys and values, keys and values. Array.from is another new piece of ECMAScript 2015 that you can use to convert array-like objects. So if you're used to arguments, which is almost an array but doesn't have array methods, or DOM node lists. So if you do not use jQuery to query the DOM, and you use document.query selector or something like that, you actually get back something that is not, even though it looks like an array in your console, it is not actually an array. It doesn't have slice or splice or any of the typical methods that you can use on it. You can use array.from as a new piece of ECMAScript 2015 to convert that automatically into an array instead of using the very odd another incantation square bracket dot slice dot call. Yes? On the array, yes, so array dot, on the map, I do not believe so. No. You can convert it into an array and have that, but there are probably other methods that, let me see. Let's look this up. So almost all of it, just like how pretty much anything on the web and with JavaScript, you can easily look up in MDN, the Mozilla Developer Network. I'm praying that I actually have internet right now. Similarly, you can look up pretty much everything in ECMAScript 2015, also in MDN. So here are all of the methods of map. Clear, delete, entries, it does not have. But you can easily convert that to an array and filter map as you need to. So now, in terms of even more obnoxious incantations that we are used to in JavaScript that are replaced by clear implementations of them, instead of having to use index of in arrays, we are able to use a new function on arrays, a new prototype method on arrays called find. Find is, it takes a function, and this is an example of an arrow function that I'll explain a little bit more later, that can tell you what, so here, this will find you an element that happens to be 3. The few features that we're using here in addition to find are arrow function. So this is a much smaller and cleaner syntax for this. Those are the same thing, but you don't have to type all of the F-U-N-C-T-I-O-N that some people happen to be very annoyed with. Yes. I forgot the semicolon, yes. I know, I feel so ashamed. So it is really, in the example I have just described, it is purely a syntactical thing. And you don't have to type the return, but there are semantic differences that I will get into in a little bit, in a more complicated slide a little bit later. So object.is, additionally, is a way for us to, it is similar to triple equals, except it works with some of the magic and an, oh, sorry about that. It works with some of the magic like NaN and infinity. Great. So we are able to add both find and object.is with this with ES6 shim. Here are some examples. So if more people had laptops here, I would encourage us to wait for a few minutes, have everyone actually try some of these. These are great examples in a website called ES6 Katas, which I'll show you in a second. So these are examples that will actually get you to pass many TDD style tests to be able to test your knowledge of maps, sets, arrays, lots of the different features in ECMAScript 2015. So I appear to be having some technical difficulties. Okay, sorry, I don't know what happened. I have control again. So all of these features, I've listed about 10 of them. There are dozens or more. All of these you can add into your projects, no matter what their platform, no matter what their system, with a single script tag that, again, I know you're all able to do. So if any of these things you want, you can add this in 5 minutes, 10 minutes. It is a download and an adding of script tag. But there are many, many more things, that some of which I described already, and some of which I have not, that you can't quite just add to ECMAScript 5. They are not globals or pieces of prototypes that you can just add functions to, but rather they are new syntaxes or new semantics that if you were a computer that can spit out new code, it's fairly straightforward, but you can't just add into existing runtimes. And these are what I call the transpilables. These are all of the features that are in this category where you can't just add it with a script tag, but you can add it with a build step. So similar to the CoffeeScripts and TypeScripts of the world, if you have a build step already, or if you add something into your pipeline, no matter what your backend platform or framework, you can add a step that will take your ECMAScript 2015, convert that into ECMAScript 5, that then actually gets run in a browser and has the same correct semantics as it would be if ECMAScript 2015 was actually implemented in that browser. And the way that you can do that is using a few tools. So Babel is the most popular by far, but there are a few different options here. If you are using Gulp, Grunt, all the other front-end build tools, there are plugins for these tools. What Babel, JS Transform, and Tracer do are similar to CoffeeScript and TypeScript. They take ECMAScript 2015, look through it all, convert that into ECMAScript 5, and we'll write that to disk somewhere for you. I am actually using, in these slides, I am using Babel to take the string that's written into this ACE editor, convert that from ECMAScript 2015 into ECMAScript 5, and then evaling that. Oh, Douglas Crocker wouldn't like that either. I am evaling that on the fly for you. So what questions do you have? Okay. So as far as I know, so the question was, why haven't I listed TypeScript here? TypeScript is not, as far as I know, intended to map exactly one-to-one with the ES2015 standard. They have many features that are in addition to ES2015, as well as they do not have all of the features of ES2015. Whereas the goal of these projects in general is to map as closely as possible to the new version of JavaScript. But TypeScript does have, similarly with CoffeeScript, at least the ones that we have taken wholeheartedly, many features of ECMAScript 2015 have been implemented in TypeScript. So if you're using TypeScript already, many of these things can be used. I don't actually know which ones, but many of them. Arrow functions and classes. That's not a lot. I thought it was going to be many more things than that. Right. Okay, so the first thing I want to talk about is something called block scoped variables. And if you are in the Java C, C++ world, this is something that's very familiar to you. But so I don't know about you, but I have been asked a particular interview question many times over my life as a JavaScript developer. And I've been a little bit annoyed by it after seeing it so many times. And I hope I have never asked it myself. And I don't know if any of you looking at this can immediately tell what I'm trying to get to here. But well, I'll just describe this piece of code out loud. I have an array that with values 1, 2, and 3. I have another array for output. I create a for loop. I iterate through that array, and I create a new function that's pushed onto the output that alerts the values in that alerts the value at that index of the array. And then for each of those output functions, I call them and actually execute them. So does anyone know what is going to be alerted when I click on run here? No, everyone, a lot of threes. No one's going to try me with the 1, 2, and 3 thing. Everyone knows JavaScript so well. Okay, so yes, you are correct. The answer is 3, 3, and 3. But this is the most surprising thing for someone who does it. We all apparently know JavaScript very well. I don't know what I'm doing up here. But the language does not make, it's very opaque here. Because as someone who, let's say I was not extremely interested in the programming language and really understood the semantics of var, which apparently we all do, I look at this and think, it should be 1, 2, and 3. What on earth is wrong here? And the reason for that is because this variable here is not scoped to that for loop, but rather scoped to the entire code here, the function itself, whatever's being executed around this. So because of that, at any one given time, there is only one variable called val, which means at the end of this, that val will be the value 3. And at the time at which all of these functions are executed, that val is the number 3. So everyone is correct. It just does alert 1, 2, and 3. But this is completely breaking the law of the principle of least surprise, or whatever that is. It looks like it should do something that it doesn't do. And in order to get that to work correctly, without ECMAScript 2015, there's a lot of jumping through hoops you need to do around creating a new function and creating new scope so that you are able to capture a new variable whose value is 1, then value is 2, value is 3. But with ECMAScript 6, we are able to add a new, we're able to use a new keyword called let, which is actually block scoped. So here, in terms of the interview question that you would have all passed, now it would have been with flying colors, we will be able to get 1, 2, and 3. Because that let, for each iteration of this for loop, there is a different variable let being created, because it is scoped to the block. The block is between the two curly braces. This also allows us to do things like, instead of creating an iffy, you know the word iffy, I-F-F-E? So immediately invoked function expression, it is how most jQuery plugins, for example, are wrapped in something like that. This is to make sure that you don't accidentally leak into the global to cut everything off from the outside world. With this new block scoped variable creation, we can create something like inside just two curly braces, as long as everything is using let, everything is already scoped to that block and cannot leak out into the global. So what questions do you have? Yes. So let is, the question was, let is normally used for constants, right? So const is actually a separate and different way to create block scoped variables, which happens to be my next slide, so I'll talk to you about it in a second. What other questions do you have? So the scope of a block, so the question was, is there any memory optimizations that the interpreter is doing here? So I don't believe that there is any more optimization than the fact that it does go out of scope at the end of that block. So the variables have a smaller scope than just a regular var, which I presume means that it is garbage collected more, but I don't know. I don't know in detail. But in certain cases, and I think I might, so the way that let works in certain cases, if you are using transpiled code, and this is just more for interest necessarily than actually caring about using this, in some rare cases, the only way to get, so there is actually one piece of semantics in ECMAScript 5 that obeys block scoping, which is the exception in a caught exception handler. So if you write try catch, that E that is caught is actually block scoped only to the curly braces that catch is. So some old transpilers used to, in very unperformant ways, use catch to mimic block scope, because it's the only thing in ECMAScript 5 that really exhibits the correct semantics. But most of that is no longer used. What other questions? Yes. So there is, so let is not hoisted at all in terms of the actual specification, but there are certain cases using the transpiled code where it will be, because there is no there's no way to mimic the exact semantics. You can presume that they are only supposed to be used within the curly braces that they are defined in, and in the correct implementation, they are actually unusable before the line at which they are defined. So if I try to do something like, this should give me a reference error. It will not in this particular case, because using Babel, using these transpilers, it cannot mimic the exact semantics. But this is the way that it works. Undefined. Because it's... Oh, yes, potentially. I think I have turned those things off. Yes. For ease of demonstration purposes. Okay, so then so there is one more way to have block scoped variables in JavaScript. One is let, which is obviously the most common. It is within the curly braces. Const is very similar. It is still block scoped. If you put this into two curly braces, they will stay within the scope of the variable. The scope of the constant will be within those curly braces. But it does enforce some very minimal semantics around changing the value of that constant. So here, when I create a const x equals 1 and try to run it, I get an error. Line x is read-only on line 3. This is something just because I put a try-catch around everything in here and alert all of the error messages. But this new feature of ECMAScript 2015 will force you to not change references in constants, basically. Again, another block-scoped variable creation. Yes. It throws an error. It actually throws an error. That it is read-only. I think it is intended to be for early catching of mistakes instead of silent not catching of mistakes. Okay, so now we are going to get into a fairly long and complicated one for arrow functions. But since we are about at 2 minutes before a break, I will let us all take that break, come back here, and continue afterward. Does that sound good? Great. Okay, thank you all. I will see you all in a few minutes. I just took it, very disappointed in my score. I did not do very well. I didn't do poorly, but I didn't do very well. I encourage you all to take it. Getting one question right, you're really happy anyway, so go for it. So I'm going to get started with arrow functions in a second. Again, so thank you all for continuing to ask me questions and continuing to keep me on time, because we're going to make this work, as you have all been requested to. Again, the fresh desk quiz, very interesting. It actually goes through some of the interesting semantics we're talking about here. Some of the ones I have gotten wrong, I'm a little embarrassed about, but I'm still happy about it in general, and I encourage you all to go try it. So please continue to raise your hands, ask me questions, I'll be asking as we go. So now on to the next item that is transpilable. It's something that we used a little bit earlier, but I didn't go into much detail about it. And someone asked a question that I have deferred to almost right now. So arrow functions are a feature that we in ECMAScript basically directly stole from CoffeeScript. And at its smallest level, it is just syntactical convenience over functions. So here I have created a function double that uses this syntax. This syntax is equivalent to, so running this I get 20. This syntax is equivalent to typing function here, changing this to curly return. Great semicolon at the end, and again, this is the same thing. Oh, wow. You are a JS hint for me. This is great. So, thanks to human JS hint and the ability for my keyboard to continue to type semicolons, we have a semantically and syntactically correct way to double something. So in this particular example, it is almost purely syntactic sugar. All you do is remove the function, remove the return, change this here. And you get the same thing. But that is only the simplest case of what is happening for the fat arrow arrow function. What is more complicated to understand is what is happening around the binding of this when you're using the arrow function syntax. So what is happening for the fat arrow? So how many of you have used function.prototype.bind? Okay. So in JavaScript, there is a little bit of special treatment to the keyword this. Whenever looking up a property on this, you have to consider what this is referencing. In the typical case, if you're just in a global file in a browser somewhere, this is the window, the global. When you are in an object, or when you're calling a function, what is on the right-hand side of the dot is typically what becomes this inside of that function. So here, I'll show you. I am creating a variable that's empty. I'm creating an object that is, I'm creating an object that has a location value and an initialize function. And inside of that, I am assigning to this global alert lock variable. Here, if I run this, you'll see that I get we're at Bangalore. But if I change this to the value, the thing that I said earlier was syntactically the same thing. If I change this to just a function, which seems to be exactly the same, and I run again this, I'm sorry? I forgot that earlier. So please raise your hand when I have a semicolon. No, don't worry about it. So again, here, all I did was do the same transformation that I did earlier with double. I changed the fat arrow syntax into a function. But this time, I get an error, which is cannot read property lock of undefined, which means that something has happened between the changing of the arrow function syntax to the regular function expression syntax. What that changes is that this is bound to a different thing. When I do not use the fat arrow, this is bound to, in strict mode, undefined. So when I am running this, it says cannot read property lock of undefined as an error because this is undefined when you just use a regular function. But when you use the fat arrow, oops, this works. Now, why does this work? This works because what is happening with the arrow function is that it automatically binds this to whatever this, the value this, is in the context that it is defined in. So this is similar to how, if I go back to the function version, if I dot bind this, again, this works correctly. So fat arrow is doing something a little bit more. The arrow function syntax is doing something a little bit more than just saying, don't worry about typing F-U-N-C-T-I-O-N, because that's the worst thing for your fingers to do on your keyboard. it is also automatically binding the value of this to the value of this in the context in which it is defined. So this is a fairly advanced topic, and is a little bit of, it is confusing around one using the word this in a sentence is sort of difficult anyway. But what questions do you have around what this new feature does in addition to just changing syntax? So someone earlier asked the question as to what the difference is between fat arrow and a regular function. Most of the time it is syntax, but it is also this one very specific and very interesting difference. Also, when you use the arrow function syntax, you cannot call or apply and override the this context. Most functions in JavaScript defined this way, you can do something like, you can call that function with a different this. You cannot do that with arrow functions as well. There's no way to avoid this default. So the part of the reasoning behind the arrow function is this difference. So no, you cannot avoid. You can, the only way to avoid it is to use the regular functions. It's all the typing. It's so annoying, I get it. OK, so again, this is another feature that, using a transpiler, we have access to. We don't have to wait until the whole language is actually shipped in all of the browsers. We can add something like this into our build process and be able to use it. So the next feature that I'm going to lump into a few different pieces here is destructuring. So you've seen some examples of this already. This is another feature stolen from the Lisps of the world that will allow, we don't have to spend, usually, and this is probably true in most of the code that you write, and some of the code I write anyway, because I'm not always writing in ECMAScript 2015. The first few lines of our function is spent plucking things out of all of the arguments. So we have maybe an options argument and a few other arguments, and our first few lines is take the second item of this array and assign that to a variable that I actually want to use in my function. Take a property off the second argument, and I want to use that as the argument to the function. Now, using a syntax like this, we can break apart arguments to functions, we can break apart variables into their component pieces using this syntax. So here, instead of having to write something like, instead of having to write all of this out like we do in the beginning of most functions, we can break that apart directly inside of the definition of the function. And here again, this just works. These structures 2, 1, and 3. It is basically a syntactic convenience around breaking up different parts of objects and arrays. Yes? Is it possible to do that in maps? I know it is possible to do this with objects. I do not know if it is possible to do in maps. I'll look that up and we can talk about that later. It's not. I don't think so, but we will figure it out.
Somebody wanted to push this in ES7, but apparently they're
already in maps. Ah, so it might be there are arguments for future versions. But you can do this for objects, so if I do. I believe this will work, yes. So you can break apart objects in a very similar way to get the key. Objects and arrays are still special syntaxes in JavaScript. Maps are just objects and implement iterables. Yes? Dispatch based, is that what you said?
Can dispatch based on the structure?
No, this is just destructuring, just creating new variables, yes. I have more Scala to learn. I'll talk to you about it after. What other questions do you have? You can destructure arrays, you can destructure objects, and you can take apart as many pieces and as deeply as you want to go. So, I think that if you just use regular let me try that. That's a good question. The question is, if you have multiple elements and you don't want to destructure all of them, how can you do that? I think that you can just do this. Yeah, so you need that many commas, basically, but you don't need them. I think it's a fairly common convention to do something like this, with underscore being things I don't care about, but you don't need that. You can just put commas for the empty slots that you don't care about. This particular piece only works for fixed size, yes. I don't know if there is a way to get first and last. Yeah. In terms of destructuring. So if there were more, so for example, actually I don't know if REST can do this. So if you're passing things to a function, there's something called REST arguments, where you can, if you do something like this, your whatever arguments you pass to this function, so let's say I pass this. I'm sorry? Ah, okay. We'll talk about that. So, using another feature of ECMAScript 2015 that is not destructuring, you're able to pass in using this three dot syntax. This is called REST parameters. Now, REST is an actual array. So, here, you get all of the pieces as an array, and you can use the array methods like for each, for example. I don't know if you can, you mean something like, so you can do this. So A comma B comma this. So then here. So here you can get the first one, the second one as separate variables, and then using REST, which is just an array, you can break apart all the rest of them. If that makes sense. Okay. So here I have an example of something similar to the question that was just asked. So we can put together a lot of these new features to make some pretty esoteric syntaxes that most are not used to, but eventually we will get used to in JavaScript. So here, I am using, I'm creating a function called destructure that again takes this REST arguments, which I showed you as an example earlier. I then break apart those arguments into two different pieces. One is options, one is the callback. And here I can, if I call this, passed with the object defined here, that I forgot a semicolon for, I apologize. And then run this, you get true, which is the value of the V property in options, and the type of the second thing, which is function. Now here, I can also do something like, which will again give me the same thing, because you can actually destructure in JavaScript deeply. So inside, if an array has an object inside of it, you can destructure the array and the object at the same time, which is what this syntax is doing. Some of these can get very esoteric and unreadable, so use these kinds of features mixedly with caution, but you're able to do all of this because they're all relying on the same sort of destructuring syntax and semantics. What questions do you have? Okay. So now I'm going to talk to template strings. So this is one of these things that we, I don't know if you, about you, I have been so annoyed at all of my life in JavaScript having to write string plus, string plus, string. I've made at least a dozen JS fiddles that will take an arbitrary text area and just break it by 80 character lengths, so I don't have to do that myself. Understandably, there should be a tool for this. But now we have, as the Ruby people have been jealous, or not, no, we've been jealous of the Ruby people, they've been making fun of JavaScript people because we have not had for a long time. We now have template strings, which is easily able to interpolate variables into stringing them and put them into strings. And you know, so this is, of all of the things, we have template language for a lot of these things, so it's not like, this is not by itself extremely impressive, but what for me is way more impressive is that I can now enter new lines in my string, and that just works. I should drop, if I had a mic, I would drop it. That's amazing. It has taken so long, and so many times of me having to type slash n, slash r slash n, figuring out what line endings I'm in, and now we just hit enter. It's great. So this one's fairly straightforward, but what questions do you have about template strings? Reading the transpiled output of this is very straightforward and simple because it is just concatenating strings together and figuring out how many new lines to be adding into pieces that I'm pretty happy about. Oh, I missed another semicolon. I'm apparently don't care about semicolons. I apologize. Yes. No. So, template strings require you to use the backtick. So it is not a single quote; it is a backtick. And there is actually an additional feature of this, where you can actually pass into a handler. This is much more customizable than what I've described here. This is the most basic use of template strings, which are just concatenation of different pieces together. But if you want to, you can use something called a template handler, which will allow you to be given the, in a particular data structure defined by the language, the pieces that are static, so the I'm space, the pieces that are non-static, and will allow you to do things like escaping HTML appropriately. Or automatically, there's an interesting one that is SH, so it will convert whatever you have into a correct bashable form automatically for you. So you can write your own custom template handlers that will do more interesting things than just concatenate. Most notably, escape appropriately for whatever system you're using. Yes? You mean? So what's there in the dollar gets to stringed. It is to stringed, yes. So a function, yeah, I guess, I don't know, whatever. Whatever to string the function would be, it just gets to string. Yes. Yes, you can. So you could do. So you can write expressions. Again, they are all to stringed afterwards. So whatever you put in there, you can do it. Although I would recommend not doing that much inside of the template string, but you can evaluate things inside of there. Yes. OK, so now I'm going to get on into the generators. So how many of you have used generators before? Any language? OK, so this is a bit of a mind-stretching exercise. So I should ask you all, can you want to try with me? Yeah, you got to get the mind going. OK. So generators are a new feature in ECMAScript 2015 that allow you to create what are actually iterators, but they look like functions that never have to end. And they look that way, and they're differentiated by this special new star that means everything is different now. So be prepared for it. What this returns is, so a generator is a function defined with a star at the end that is able to use something called yield. So the yield keyword, it allows you to pause the execution of functions midstream. So this is something that looks, it has a while true in it. And it, if this, and it looks like this would be something that would run infinitely. But what this actually does is allow you to externally from the generator pause between executions of the generator. So this function, when executed, will run until the yield, so it will create a variable, while true, run until the yield. And once the yield is executed, it will give up control to whatever is executing the generator until the generator again gets called. So how that works is a syntax I'm not going to go into significantly here. But the way that you can use that is, this is an example of a generator that represents the infinite series of integers. So it is the numbers that go on forever. Using the for of syntax again, we can pluck things out of that generator, because what generators return are iterators. And the for of syntax is used on top of iterators. So here I will go through the first three numbers. Oops. Apparently I did. That doesn't make sense, though. Is the Wi-Fi working? Will be momentarily. Okay, so I will move, let my internet actually hopefully connect, and I'll come back to this in a little bit. I'm a little confused as to how that happened. Okay. So next and last on our jaunt through this, and I'll come back to generators in a little bit, is the class syntax. So class syntax has been a fairly controversial one in the grand scheme of JavaScript, mainly because some people are afraid of it looking like Java, and other people are afraid that it doesn't look enough like Java. So at some point between this tension, a winner came out, which is, we have class syntax. It is actually, it is purely syntactic sugar in the general case on top of regular prototypal inheritance in JavaScript. It allows us to do some nice things like actually give interfaces, allows us to extend arrays. Right now in ECMAScript 5, we cannot actually extend arrays. We can only do things that are close to it. Here is an example of creating a class. It has a constructor just like anything else. You can access super. And here, just as an example, we are able to run this. It says, hey, because it calls the greet method. You can have as complicated object hierarchies as you want to, although it is recommended not to be so complicated. This is, again, nothing you couldn't do in JavaScript, in ECMAScript 5. There's nothing particularly special here. But it does give the nice familiar syntax for people coming from more classically object-oriented programming languages. What questions do you have? Yes? Yes, you can. So everything on this, so the question was, can you access greeter.message? And the answer is, yes, you can. So what, everything here is public by default. That's true for JavaScript just in general. Properties of objects are generally public. But using another new feature of ECMAScript 2015 called symbols, we are able to create private symbols to be able to add private things to objects. I'm not going to go through that here, but if you would like to learn how to make things that are really private, you know, Java C Sharp style private, that is now possible, and I would love to talk to you about it. We can talk about that afterward. Yes, this is all. So all this is doing is automatically creating the right greeter.prototype.blank methods for you. If you look at the transpiled output, which let's see if that is loaded. If you look at the transpiled output, it is basically that one-to-one. Okay. Oh, I didn't know you mean, I don't know. Oh, this. Right, yeah, so the, so class, this is also, again, similar to existing JavaScript things. The class syntax automatically creates those prototype methods for you, but you're also able to, you whatever inside of these curly braces, you're able to add whatever you want to that function itself. So, world, this is added directly there. Is that what you mean? I don't use that. I don't use that ever. But that is possible. Let me see if this worked. I'm trying to get back to the REPL so that I can show you that generator example, because I'm still confused, and I apologize for that. But we will, if I do not get that working right now, I would love to talk to you about that after. So again, there are many more examples in here that I'd love for you to actually play with, because there are live interactive demos that you can see, confirm your understanding of some of these things, and then ask questions about for me. So I'll be here the whole time. I'd love to talk to you about it afterward as you go through these things and help out. So I do have some examples of the modules and the module syntax. Let me see if I can get that running. Apparently, I cannot. Apparently, my keyboard is not working. I will continue with this. So there are, inside the repository that I have this presentation is, that I shared the link for earlier, I have a few examples of the different module syntaxes. So, sorry, of modules and how we can use them in ECMAScript 6. There are, after a lot of discussion, and some heatedly so, there is a very robust module system built into ECMAScript 2015. It's one of the large lacking of JavaScript so far, because pretty much every other programming language has some sort of module system such that you can separate out files. But we've been living in a world of only globals and namespacing for basically our entire careers in whatever JavaScript you've been writing. Using the new module system syntax is something that basically appeals to all of the different use cases, both on the client and the server, that you might have for using JavaScript. It's something that if you are familiar with the module systems of Python, Ruby, things like that, it's very straightforward as to what JavaScript is trying to do. And again, I will talk to you about that further afterward. So there are some pieces of JavaScript that are not in this category of being able to be transpiled into or transpiled into a version that the browser can actually use. There are some intractable pieces, just like this insane Rubik's Cube that someone might try, but I will never be able to win, that we cannot yet use until browsers start to implement them. Gratefully, there are already pieces of this that are being implemented by JavaScript engines, but not yet necessarily everywhere. The first one of these is weak maps. So this is something that library authors have to care about more than user land people, but it is basically a way to optimize memory usage in maps and optimize garbage collection and making sure that it doesn't that the map itself does not hold references to things. That's not something necessarily very useful, but proxies and tail call optimization are something that especially the functional programmers of the world are very, very interested in having in the language itself. Proxies are a mechanism by which you can extend the language to be able to add metaprogramming hooks into JavaScript. So if you are familiar with Ruby's method missing, or being able to add meta classes in Python, this is the ability to create objects that stand in for other objects and can forward property lookups and method lookups to other objects as need be. This is a new feature that we cannot mimic at all in current JavaScript engines, and once is actually implemented and more widely available, will make things like two-way data binding, although not necessarily as cool now as it was a year ago, will make two-way data binding and things like that very simple and straightforward because we're able to hook into JavaScript engines much more than we're able to right now. Additionally, tail call optimization is something that in certain cases we are actually able to transpile away, but in the general case when writing recursive code, although I will admit that I'm not one who writes significant amounts of recursive code, the JavaScript engine is able to optimize that significantly away for you. So you don't have to worry about blowing through stacks or calling a function 10,000 times. All of that will eventually be handled by the language itself. These are some of the most complicated and interesting changes in the language, but they're farthest from the general developer public being able to use on a regular basis. Oh, I didn't know that. Oh, great. So there is a way to mimic some of these things. Similarly, with tail call optimization, you can. I'm not going to try to implement that algorithm myself, but I'm glad it exists. So what questions do you have? Okay, so I have just scratched the surface of the iceberg that is ECMAScript 2015. I've already spent about an hour and 30 minutes or so, and I have covered maybe a dozen or two of all of the features that have been added. There are on the order of 125 new what's called features. Some of them are sub-features of other things. There is a great list that if you have these slides you can click through that Kangax has put together of all of the new features, over 100 different pieces of them, and all of the different browsers and transpilers that implement pieces of it or not. So you can take a look at this and go through some of them. Many of them are in the category of shimmables. You can have that tomorrow. Some of them are transpilable. You can have them in a week, because I believe in all of you, that all you have to do is sit there and figure out a build tool. And then there are many pieces in here that I have not talked about that this site has great examples for, that MDN has great examples for. And especially when you consider the fact that many of the great pieces that were intended for ECMAScript 2015 have been pushed to 2016 and 2017. The list of new features that we are basically guaranteed over the next 3 years is even more interesting and even more holistic. We are getting a whole range of very, very fun new concepts that, again, many are spilled in from other programming languages. Gratefully, we don't care about plagiarism. So what I think that you should do walking out of here, and I know that at least some of you, I have seen the glint in your eyes about not having to type plus signs at the end of strings to concatenate, or not having to type index of is greater than -1, because where on earth did that even come from? There's probably some background for it that I don't know. But I know that there are people out there that want to and can go and add ES6 shim. Just throw it in a branch. Your manager doesn't even have to know. Tell them John Paul told you to do it at a conference. And they will not care. Realistically, no one even needs to know, because you add this script tag, and if you never use these features, you never have to use these features. It's completely backwards compatible. That's another piece of the ECMAScript philosophy. Because JavaScript is something that ties the web together and has been tying the web together for over a decade, JavaScript has worked very, very hard to be completely backwards compatible. Therefore, you can easily add these things, never use the features, and no one has to concern themselves with it at all. And gratefully, we're not breaking any websites from any time in the past by pulling off all of these new features we get to use. I encourage you to read these people's blogs. So Axel Ruschmeier, Aria Hidayat, and Adi Osmani, they are prolific writers, as well as Nicholas Zekas and a few others are prolific writers about ECMAScript 6, the new features therein, their particular gotchas, and their particular very interesting and useful pieces. Add a branch with the transpiler, because again, one, speaker at conference told you you were able to do it, so you can get away with it with any manager. But the amount of work here to do is not that, especially if you have a build tool already in place, if you're in the CoffeeScript or TypeScript world, or if you have a build tool that just concatenates all of your scripts and minifies, adding in a transpile step is maybe an hour, maybe a day, maybe a week, but it's not 6 months. And being able to start to build into your workflow these new features and more future-facing things really gets me excited, even if I don't use anything. It just gets me excited that they're there and that I can. And eventually, we'll start to migrate things over. So I think you should do that. So I think it's hard to get through any talk without using any memes. So go transpile and shim everything. Thank you so much for listening to me. I appreciate it. What questions do you have? There's definitely time to go back through some of these things. And I know that I've dumped a lot of information, all of you. So thank you. How many of you had already added the script tag? Anyone? No? It's so easy. I know you have your code sitting on your laptop. So using the modules, the question was, how do you import classes if you have them in a separate file? So classes are just like how JavaScript right now, if you want to create a class in ECMAScript 5, you are just creating a function. That function can be used new and make a new instance of that class. So similarly, ECMAScript 2015 classes are just functions. When you use this class syntax that I showed here, greeter is a function. If you type of that, it's just a function. So whatever you could do with the module system using functions, you can do with classes. They're not particularly special. This is one of those things that are a little bit confusing, the fact that you're using the class keyword and it generates a function, not something else special. But this is just syntactic sugar. That's the thing to remember. Yes. So arrow functions are able to be assigned to variables, just like, so let me see if I can go all the way back here. Yes, so here, so this is an arrow function here on the left. This is an arrow function. It is assigned to this variable. You can use them just like wherever you would syntactically use a function expression. So you can assign it to a variable, you can pass it as a parameter to a function, you can use them anywhere. What other questions do you have? Mm-hmm. So you cannot write interfaces that are checked interfaces in ECMAScript 2015. You can write classes that implement interfaces in ECMAScript 2015. I believe that in future versions, there is intended to be things like language-supported ways of checking that. but there's no straight comparison with Java interfaces to be able to do. That would require a type system, yes. Well, yeah. Duck typing means you can make anything into any interface, so yes, that way. TypeScript can do it for you. Okay, sounds good. Thank you so much.